All right, are we rolling? I had to ask that because we are streamed live on YouTube, so that's why I had to check if the camera is rolling. It's rolling. Good. Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to the third in our series of seminars of approaching the Warsaw, NATO Warsaw Summit. In the first seminar, we looked at the Wales Declaration, Wales Summit, and looked at the implementation of that. In the second one, we looked at more at Warsaw and asked if NATO is preparing to do the right things. And this time we kind of take focus a little bit on our own neighborhood. We'll look at the Nordic security. We will look at especially Sweden and Finland. This is important for several reasons. Of course, it's always natural, geopolitically speaking, that we will look at our own neighborhood. But of course, it has been a kind of center of some of the tension that we've seen between West and Russia recently has taken place, at least in the Baltic Sea. So it's important we look at that. If we had some developments in Finland and Sweden when it comes to attitudes towards NATO. And as you all know, our prime ministers, the four Nordic prime ministers, are meeting with President Obama in a few days' time. We don't know the details of that meeting, of course, but we do know that security cooperation is on top of the agenda. So there will come something out of that which might have implications for our policy, security policies in our part of the world. Now, to address these topics, we have three excellent scholars. I'm really proud. Oh, let me say one thing first, very important. Who funds us? Norwegian Minister of Defense and NATO Public Diplomacy Division has supported this event, so we're thankful for them. Now, to the speakers. We have three excellent speakers. First, I will introduce them as they speak, but the first one is Malena Britz. She's a senior researcher and professor at the Swedish Defense College. She's also deputy director as of Monday, as I got it right. You have a PhD in political science from University of Stockholm. Former researcher at the Stockholm Center for Organizational Research, and you published a lot on European security and defense policies. And of course, Swedish security. And you have just about to finalize the book on how certain European countries had a decision-making process when deploying troops abroad. Was that the right way of putting it? Interesting comparative analysis, how countries take a decision of whether to deploy or not deploy. So that's a book which is coming out in, in September, so be prepared. All right, so I'll introduce the two other speakers afterwards. They will talk about 15, 20 minutes each, and then we will, of course, open for Q&A from the audience. So please, the floor is yours, Malena.
Thank you. And thanks for inviting me. I feel like a rock star now with this. I'm going to talk about Sweden and Sweden as an ambivalent partner to the other Nordic states who are or who are not members of NATO. And I was thinking mostly of Sweden from a sort of Norwegian perspective when I wrote this. So because I guess that for Norway, Sweden is more of an ambivalent partner than for Finland. For Finland, Sweden is a clear partner, I guess. That's my guess. But I'm also going to talk a bit about Swedish NATO membership, about the debate about the Swedish NATO membership, because that is very lively right now in Sweden. Where do I direct it to change the slide? Technology, never to be trusted.
Yeah, I tried it out just before you came.
Yes. Okay. So the next line poses what I think is an interesting question that sets the scene for the Swedish NATO debate, and that is, how can Swedish military non-alignment, solidarity policy, and the defense of Swedish territory be combined? I think that question puts the scene for most of the NATO debate today, and how your sort of your views on Swedish NATO membership is decided on different, what you think on the different, on those different aspects of the military non-alignment, on the solidarity policy, and the defense of Swedish territory. Oh yes, there it is. Very good. Thank you. What has happened, I'm just briefly going to talk a little bit about what has happened in the political discussion in Sweden in these last years. And obviously, as all of you know, there have been a lot of changes in the strategic environment for all the Nordic countries since the end of the Cold War. And for Sweden, with regard to defense policy, this has meant that Sweden, during the Cold War, had a defense policy where the politicians spoke about total defense, a concept of total defense, which is, if you translate it to English, because it doesn't really exist in English, is more or less the idea of a comprehensive defense, more or less. Not exactly, but more or less. And from that emphasis on total defense on the Cold War, in the Cold War, there was a change in the policy that was manifested in 2004, when the Swedish government stated that Sweden should only go abroad. We should defend Sweden from abroad. What's important for the armed Swedish armed forces is not really to defend Swedish territory anymore, but participating in international operations. That is what is important for the Swedish armed forces. That is the task that they should perform. That was in 2004. Since then, there have been other changes. And in this last defense bill that came out last year, there is a clear retreat of the armed forces to the Swedish territory again, and to being able to defend both Sweden and the territory, and the neighbors, Swedish territory and the neighbors. And the idea of the total defense also came back. The total defense was actually abolished for some years from 2009, because the total defense consists of both military defense and civilian defense. And from 2009 up until last year, then the civilian parts were not really part of defense planning anymore. Obviously, we have talked about crisis management and such things, but as part of a more general defense concept, the civilian aspects disappeared. They have come back now though. So now the issue for people working with the civilian parts is to how to incorporate the way we have worked with crisis management in the last years into a new idea of total defense. Because obviously, and this is the interesting aspect of this, and sort of the challenge for everyone who works in this area, both from a policy view or from a more practical view, is that if you revoke such a concept as the total defense, you can't do it exactly the same way as you did it during the Cold War. It has to be carried out. It's the same concept, but it has to be carried out in a different way. And no one really knows exactly how. So for me, that's an interesting aspect. What has happened is, since the Cold War, is that Sweden has gone from, you could say, a solitary player in defense issues to solidarity, with an increased cooperation in defense, in different aspects of defense cooperations, bilateral, multilateral, and also in NATO. So this is a development that has come about after the end of the Cold War, and it has continued, and it still continues. It hasn't stopped. Bringing back the idea of total defense doesn't mean that Sweden doesn't want to cooperate. It still has to cooperate a lot with both with neighbors and others. There has also been a change in opinion, both actually in the political parties and in the people, with regards to how such defense cooperation should take place, and specifically with regard to NATO membership. Before, about 9 years ago, none of the Swedish parties were, except maybe the Liberals, were in favor of Swedish membership in NATO. The Liberals have sort of always been in favor of a Swedish membership in NATO, but they are the only ones. But in the last years, all the opposition parties, except the Sweden Democrats, but the Liberals, the Conservatives, the Center Party, and the Christian Democrats, they have all during the last year, changed their policy, and they are now in favor of Swedish membership in NATO. However, they are in opposition, so they can't really do that much about it. But I think that is a significant change, because then it means that the NATO debate gets a different feeling in the public debate, when you have parties who actually say that, well, maybe we want to put this as a question. We have the next general election in 2 years, in 2018. And they say, maybe we want to have this as an important question for the next general elections. That changes a little bit the official discussion in Sweden about NATO. Nay. So, yes. Thanks. These are some figures from a recent poll that was made by Gothenburg University. And they are really interesting, I think, because they show this ambiguity in the Swedish relationship to NATO. Because if you compare the figures of people, say, agreeing with a statement saying that Sweden should apply for membership in NATO, there were only 15% in 1994 who agreed with this statement. But in 2015, at the end of last year, it was 38%. So there is a clear shift in the public opinion in favor, you could say, of NATO membership. But this is interesting, and I think it's a headache for the politicians. If you look at the numbers of undecided, it's more or less the same. The change is much smaller in the big group of undecided people, which means that you have a number of people who have changed their opinion from not that Sweden shouldn't be members of NATO to that Sweden should be. But you still have a big group of people who don't really know. Another interesting aspect of this that also shows this ambivalence is another question that was posed in the same poll. It was a statement saying Sweden should in peacetime be military non-aligned with intent to be neutral in war. 60% stated that this was a good proposition, even though 38% stated that Sweden should apply for NATO membership. So reading this poll doesn't really give the politicians that clear a statement on what the Swedish people actually want in this question. And from this you can't really read what people think that NATO is. Also, I think it's important here to remember that Swedish politicians have actually stopped talking about neutrality. There is no Swedish neutrality policy anymore, even though some people of the general public might think so. But there is no Swedish neutrality policy, and the politicians have stopped talking about that. As I stated in the beginning, the catchword these days is solidarity policy. Another poll. I also want to show a little bit how the impact of Russia actually in this. And Russian activities on Swedish opinion. Because there was another poll that was given by the Swedish Civil Contingency Agency in 2014, just after we had foreign submarines in the Swedish, in the archipelago outside Stockholm. And in that poll, 48% were in favor of Swedish NATO membership. So obviously it depends a little bit on when you poll people. And that figure was up from 30% only 2 years earlier. So, okay. Yes, now is the last one. The NATO debate, anyway, is very lively as in Sweden these days. This latest poll from Gothenburg University that I was referring to is part of that debate. There are also other actors who try to take part in this debate, not only the Swedish political parties, as I said before, the parties in the opposition have changed their minds, but also Russia has tried to have a say in this. And the Russian foreign minister gave an interview in the Swedish one of the biggest Swedish daily newspapers not very long ago, where he stated that, well, if Sweden joins NATO, there will be consequences, and the Russian armed forces, they will take measures. He didn't specify which measures, but he still said it. And that obviously has been analyzed or perceived as a very threatening expression. So the debate and that interview also sort of sparked the NATO debate. So it is a very lively debate today in Sweden about Swedish membership. My judgment here, or my sort of what I think, is that it's hard to see any changes in Swedish policy before the next general elections in 2018, unless something very serious would happen somewhere, maybe in the Baltics or so. But unless we see any important strategic changes, I don't think that there will be a Swedish change in policy on the NATO issue at the earliest in 2018. And the situation that could happen, but this is just guessing from my part, but it's, if you try to foresee sort of the Swedish NATO debate here, what could happen is that if the Swedish opposition parties, as they are stating right now, we don't know what they will state in 2 years' time, but at the moment, they seem to think that saying that if we win the elections, we will try to become members of NATO. If they still say that, and they have that as one of their important points in their election campaign, and then they win the elections, then there is a possibility that they could make a deal with the Social Democrats, because what has to happen in Sweden for something to change in this issue is that the Social Democrats have to change their minds. So if the day that the Social Democrats change their minds, then the issue will have changed. And the closest time that I can see in closest that would happen is after the elections in 2018. If the opposition alliance, the conservative or alliance wins. But we don't know about that. So what we do know is that international corporations continue and they become more encompassing. Despite this whole debate and whether or not we should stay in NATO, the international corporations are vital for Sweden. And they continue with Finland primarily, where the Swedish Minister of Defense has said that we also look at things that might happen beyond peacetime, which is a quite new, for me it's important, it's a quite new statement. It hasn't happened before that a Swedish politician has said that the international corporations we have, because so far the international corporations have only been until peace ends, and then we can't be trusted really, you know, we can't promise anything unless there's peace. But now he has stated that with Finland we are preparing things beyond peacetime. That is new. And then the enhanced cooperation with NATO, which is also important for Swedish defense policy. Also, I want to mention here that the debate is not only about what is practical, and so it contains substantive dimensions of identity and varying perceptions of the importance of Finland and Sweden as buffers between NATO and Russia, and that shouldn't be forgotten. It's a very important aspect, and obviously you could see the Russian foreign minister his statements as a part of that kind of identity construction. It's an important part of the debate, both with regard to Swedish identity, who are we? Are we a non-aligned country? Are we not a non-aligned country? But also sort of Russian identity and the idea that maybe we have to sort of take into account that the Russians have to feel important and they have to feel non-threatened. So what their identity is. So identity aspects are very important for this debate. I think my time is up. Thank you.
Thank you, Malena, for such an excellent overview of the situation in Sweden. It's really, really great to update us on this. Now let's move to Finland. Tuomas Forsberg is known to many of you, I guess, already here. He's been in the field of Nordic security for many years. Your PhD from University of Aberystwyth. You're a professor of international relations at University of Tampere. You're also adjunct professor at University of Helsinki and University of Lapland, and also worked for George C. Marshall European Center for Security Studies and the Finnish Institute of International Affairs. You, of course, work on European and foreign security policies, And Nordic Defense Cooperation, you've written a lot on that. So who's better placed than to follow up than you are? Looking forward to hear your presentation on the Finnish position.
Okay. Thank you. It's nice to be here again. And a few words, a short presentation on Finland and NATO. And if you're not interested in Finland in particular, take this as a case study into rational or non-rational decision-making of a small country in an important foreign policy issue. So the Finnish policy vis-à-vis NATO has been very paradoxical, and that is in demand of an explanation, in the sense that Finland has not joined NATO, has joined the European Union 1995 together with Sweden and Austria at the time, unfortunately not together with Norway. And Finland has not joined NATO, but has wanted to have a very intensive partnership with NATO. The official view of NATO is very positive. NATO is seen as a stabilizing factor. Cooperation with NATO is seen as a good thing and important for Finland. But then the membership in itself has been rejected for since the end of the Cold War, when the option has been there. In fact, Finland has had what people call a NATO option in government programs and foreign policy reviews. It's called the, in various words, but colloquially, NATO option, which means that Finland, it's not an option in literally terms that many have reminded of that, that you can have that whenever you want, but simply that Finland, it means that Finland can choose to join or apply for NATO membership if Finland so wants to. Of course, that's a truism in itself, simply to reserve a country reserves itself a right to apply a membership in an organization if it wants to. But it has been a important policy sentence for the last 20 years that in itself is in need of explanation. And my point is that in order to understand that policy is not cannot be explained that well through rational or strategic calculation, but through psychology and identity politics. But let's first think that if there is a rational strategic calculation, a strategic rationale in this policy of Finland, having a close relationship with NATO, but not being a NATO member, not applying for NATO membership. What is it? The first strategic rationale is being stated that there's a fear that Finland would lose or would be forced to change the policy of conscription that has been one of the cornerstones of Finnish national territorial defense. And at the same time, as a consequence of that, the national or the will to defend that has been a very high level even after the end of the Cold War, that would also weaken. So the idea that Finland can defend the whole country and there will be hundreds and thousands of Finnish men and women also today in different parts of Finland creating this territorial defense against the strategic threat would then be undermined. This rationale has been criticized from many corners that there is no evidence that NATO doesn't demand you to get rid of conscription, and there is no evidence that national or the will to defend would diminish. It's high on Norway as well and many NATO countries. But since there are many people and even military personnel in the highest top brass generals who think so, you have to think that maybe there's some background in that way of thinking as well. The other rationale is, of course, the relationship with Russia, that you think that foreign policy, the diplomatic relationship comes first, and that's a better guarantee than any military guarantee in your relations with Russia. And that's been the post-World War to thinking in Finland. And in those terms, and in general as well, you shouldn't fix what ain't broken. So that if that works, if the diplomatic agenda has worked, so why would you change that? Why would you suddenly believe that Russia is now more threatening than the Soviet Union was during the Cold War. And of course, that in itself has some bearings, and connected to that are some, I think, much weaker arguments like that were used that Finland NATO membership would have a negative effect on domestic politics on Russia. But I think that is a slight exaggeration of the importance of Finland considering Russia's domestic politics. But that was used in the 90s. One shouldn't undermine the democratic process in Russia by joining NATO in those years. There's also the strategic rationale that you better have this NATO option now as a deterrence, so that if things develop in the direction that are unpleasant, so if Russia starts to behave in a manner that is aggressive, then you can use the option and you can apply for NATO membership. Of course, the problem in that is that you better apply for NATO membership when there is no pressure and no aggression, and you do it better early than too late. But nevertheless, you can think that there is some kind of a potential strategic rationale there as well. Of course, now you don't know what or when what the conditions would be there that exact that would be fulfilled when Finns would think that now it's the time when it's not yet the immediate crisis, but it is Russia has crossed the border when Finland should. The option policy doesn't any longer work. So obviously, a military invasion into a neighboring country is not such a triggering factor in that strategic calculation, if there's any. Neither are the frequent violations of Finnish airspace or a kind of provocative diplomatic behavior by Russian generals or diplomats. Singularizing Finland in different kinds of issues as a problem, for example. But this is, of course, a matter of perception, and now it's part why the explanation is psychological. One has to say that though it's been a lot of talk about the increased military traffic in the Baltic Sea and the airspace violations, they stopped in Finland. Finland suffered much more some years back rather than during the past, say, 10 years ago. It was frequent Russian violations of Finnish airspace, not during the last years when otherwise Russia has behaved much more intensively and aggressively in the Baltic Sea area. Last but not least, there's a kind of strategic argument that Finland does a better service for world peace by remaining neutral, so that Finland can offer good services and peace mediation, etc. We can discuss whether that argument makes any sense in the first place. But of course, that's not the key core strategic calculation that would determine Finland's NATO policy. It starts and should start with the issue of national defense rather than how well Finland can serve the. But there are many people who think that should be first, but it's not. Of course, it's the minority view, but the enthusiasm of the also a little bit copying and envying Norway's role as a peace mediator with Ahtisaari and others in Finland was something that people thought that that's where Finland's role really is, and that can create more positive the environment for peace rather than joining NATO, that is anyway a instrument of military force on the global scene and therefore not contributing to peaceful conditions and development of the global politics. So the strategic thing is difficult in a sense that of course you have the strategic argument that Russia is a threat, a potential threat, and therefore you should join NATO, and you should have done it better earlier than later. But it seems to be, if you think that there's this historical experience that we survived alone, and then you shouldn't fix what isn't broken, and then the idea that you will create diplomatic problems and And in a way, the amount of protection that you would receive through NATO cancels out the problems that you create through joining NATO. So you can see that the on the strategic level, you haven't had an argument that why you should join NATO. Of course, there's the point that has been made and has been made by the by many people, but most visibly by the grey eminence of the Finnish diplomacy, Jaakko Iloniemi, that Finland is now already paying all the costs of NATO membership by sending troops to NATO operations and being perceived as close to NATO by Russia and others, but not having this Article 5 protection of NATO. So this is actually a wrong. You can't have the best of the both. You are having actually the worst of the both. Whereas the currently people tend to think, including the president, that it's somehow nice to sit on the fence. So you can have the good things from NATO by cooperating with it, and you can still have the good relations with Russia. But this is really this policy also involves risks. There is no free lunch. There is no policy that is simply in all respects perfect and good. But there are some potential danger and risks and weaknesses as well. So I mentioned some of the psychological factors. I mentioned that the way of reading historical analogies and how they affect. So the Winter War analogy is the what still prevails in Finland, and the lesson learned in that, that's also can be contested, but the lesson learned that nobody came to help us. Of course, that's been contested many times, and people now give credit to the Germans that actually helped Finland 44, but you wouldn't able to say that during the Cold War era. So the myth was there that Finland survived alone, and the in a way the wrong lesson learned also was that because Finland there was a fear in Russia, in the Soviet Union, that if Finland joined a hostile alliance, then that creates problem for Russia. But it was the neutrality policy actually that failed before the First World War, in the Winter War, the strict policy of neutrality that Finland tried to conduct, and copied that from Sweden. Okay, then the other psychological factors, like I just mentioned one, typical wishful thinking. During the 90s, all the politicians who had this very, basically, they didn't say that NATO is bad, or very few politicians said that, but they, like social democrats, said NATO is basically a good thing and we want to cooperate with NATO. But then they want to explain away why the membership is not an actual question, like saying that NATO is not going to enlarge, so this is not a topical issue. So reading all the situation so that it's never really the question that should be decided at the moment. And that's it was postponed for various reasons, so that the decision was never made. And the psychological thing really is that it is difficult to change policy. As I said, don't fix what ain't broken. It is always demanding. You have to think through, you have to justify changes. So it's far more easier for politicians to stay where you are, develop the practices that are there, rather than to make a policy change. You have to have a policy failure most often before you make a policy change. Now the question is whether 2014 and the Crimean crisis and Russia's behavior constitutes a policy failure. First thing to say is that it's been all the time calculated in that there will be conflicts, that potential conflicts of Russia and its neighbors, like Georgia, like Ukraine. So no politician really believed that Russia will be a or they may have some, in some speeches, believed in that. But I think the mainstream view has been that it is very likely that those conflicts that we've seen are there. And even now it's explained away that Ukraine is Ukraine and Georgia is Georgia, and that is different than Finland. And there's a kernel of truth We knew that those conflicts could have been there, and why should we change the policy now? Because if we believed so and made the decision on that basis 10 or 15 years or 20 years back, so why should it suddenly change? There are some factors that have changed, and I said what is the most crucial is that Russia is living in a parallel reality. It's living in a world where it denies what it's been doing, and therefore the idea that Finland can just avoid the conflict by not doing anything by itself, not creating any problems to Russia, is no longer there, because Russia can create its own realities upon which it can base its policies. And that's really the problem. Now, I mentioned also identity. I go quickly through why I think NATO issue in Finland is also identity politics. The first is that neutrality has had a very positive connotation in terms of identity, as in Sweden. And there's a generation that learned to think that neutrality is a positive thing, and we learned that lesson, and it's very hard to dislearn that. So that is one part of the identity politics. Then the other factor is that one could perhaps say that, well, if Finland has a Western identity, that should be a pushing factor towards NATO. But it isn't. People think that EU membership already decided the identity question, that Finland is a Western country because Finland is an EU country. So there's no longer that need to go further. Rather, joining NATO would be, it meets the anti-American undercurrent that is identity politics. And that's very clear that, especially during the 2000, when it would have been possible to join NATO, all the discussion was that how bad the United States is, all the war in Iraq, why should we join a military pact with such a country? So it had an effect. And then the fourth identity factor are the Baltic states. Finland's negative other has always been during the past 70 years, that Finland is not a fourth Baltic state. In the Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact, Finland was the fourth Baltic state. Many few people actually remember it these days, but since that, Finland wanted to always be a Nordic country, and Finland has been a Nordic country. So the argument was that Finland should not join NATO, because then would be danger that Finland would become again a fourth Baltic state. And that's been and used, especially the Social Democrats had used that argument in public. Finland is not a Eastern European country or a Baltic state, as an argument why former Prime Minister Paavo Lipponen used that as his key argument, even that why Finland should not join NATO. Amazing, isn't it? Okay, will there be a policy change now? Let's go through. There should be a decision by the president. There should be a decision by the government/parliament, and a positive view of the public opinion too. None of them is at the moment really positive about what are the possibilities for change. Do I have time to go this through? Would be a couple of minutes. The president. We had a Social Democrats president. Since the end of the Cold War, first Mauno Koivisto, then Martti Ahtisaari, who had an ambivalent relationship to NATO. He has been, since he stepped down, he has been supported Finland's membership in NATO. But not because of Russia's threat, but simply because Finland should be part of all the institutions where Western nations are, similar nations are, and contribute to the global good through that. But President Tarja Halonen, after him, then 2012, she was vehemently against NATO membership. She saw it as her first motivation. She almost saw it as a conspiracy that is there in the elite and bringing Finland to NATO, and she's the last guarantee that wouldn't happen. Well, she succeeded in that, but there wasn't really a conspiracy or real political force that would have major change even without her. But now we have a conservative president, Sauli Niinistö, since 2012. And when he challenged Halonen in 2006, he spoke very favorably on NATO, because he was the underdog. He was challenging. He got more points because he did that. But when he was then the main candidate of in 2012, he was much more silent, and he has been cautious since that. And there are a couple of reasons, and cautious and cryptic at the same time. A couple of reasons for that. It's he didn't need to play the NATO card because he had more risks than benefits, because he had the majority support in the polls. But the, when he is now a president, the president's main duty, we have a very ambivalent constitution, I won't go into detail, but it's the prime minister who takes care of the EU relations, and therefore almost everything that is foreign policy related goes through EU. But the bilateral relations with Russia is seen the domain of the president. And if the president doesn't want to be a ceremonial leader, he sees that he needs to have this direct link to Putin and play that. And if he then promotes Finland's membership in NATO, he will lose that connection to Putin. So it's institutionally geared towards not supporting NATO, whoever is Finland's president, even the conservative president who basically has been in favor of NATO. And then we don't know what kind of talks they actually have had with Putin and what kinds of threats or incentives or whatever goes there, so to influence the president on that level. The government or the parliament, we have four main parties, and there should be at least two, or if you think that this is an important decision, so maybe three of the main parties should be in favor of NATO. The one party is of the bigger parties, Conservative Party, has been since 2005, I guess, officially. And that's clear. They would support Finland's membership in NATO. But then you would need another party. The true Finns, amazingly, they are might be in favor of NATO membership. They don't say it loud. Their supporters are not. This is actually opposite in Sweden, where the Sverigedemokraterna and the party is against the membership in NATO, but those who vote for them are more supportive. In Finland, it's the opposite, a little bit. Though it's not official. But even the foreign minister Timo Soini, the head of the True Finns, spoke very favorably of the United States just yesterday, and implicitly it's been. I mean, the EU is the main enemy. NATO is better than the EU. It's like the Conservative Party in the UK. That's the model where NATO is a good thing, basically, and the EU bad. But it's been the second largest party, but now in polls they only get 8%, so you never know how big it will be in the next elections. The Social Democrats, that's been the anti-NATO party, but there are voices who are in favor of NATO. For example, the head of the Finnish Atlantic Committee, Liisa Jaakonsaari, has been spoken, said just recently that NATO is basically a social democratic project. But you don't get the majority inside the Social Democrats. And the center party, that's been the Kekkonen party, the tradition, carrier the tradition. You have some people there who are supportive of NATO, but basically you have also the old school there as well. And it would be not, I mean, either of these parties should become a small party, or they should change the opinion before you have the majority in the parliament, the government in support of NATO membership. Just say that Greens have been actually more pro-NATO than in Finland, and they have those who have, many of Greens have changed their opinions because of the crisis. If you change, what has changed? It hasn't actually changed much, and now I go to the public opinion, because the public opinion hasn't changed that much. It has changed a little bit, but still, last year it was 28% in favor of NATO membership. A large number who are undecided, of course, but the opponents are still bigger number, 40-something, than and the year before it was 30% in favor of. So, and it was somewhat over 20 before the crisis. So you have a couple of percentage unit rising in support of NATO, but not too much. And all the psychological factors I mentioned maybe explains that. But also the factor that if you had the president speaking on behalf of the NATO membership, then you might have the majority. This is a bit unclear. Many those who are favor NATO used the argument that the president should go and say that we should join NATO, and then the public opinion would follow. But the presidents have actually spoken against that. They said that we can't do that. We can't do that. You can't know. In these days, you can't really believe that you have no authority who says that how public opinion, what should it believe. So maybe it's a cover also for the president not to speak on behalf of NATO membership and say that, well, the public opinion wouldn't follow. But if you have a referendum and that's been promised and that's a tricky issue, then the public opinion should be in favor. But now many people have said, in these circumstances, how can you organize a referendum? That would be like a invitation of Russia to intervene in all kinds of ways in that debate. Okay, then the last thing, what could change? If Russia's policy do not change Finnish policy that much, if the United States, I mean, there was this anti-American current, but didn't change that much, even when Obama was so popular, more popular, didn't change the NATO opinion, what would change? Sweden would change the opinion in Finland in the same way as Finland joined the European Union, applied European Union membership. The president was asked the question on TV, and he said, well, I won't speculate. I won't speculate even if the heaven would fall. But he looked like as if exactly that if Sweden would announce they would join, apply for NATO membership, would the same thing that the heaven would fall. The president wouldn't know what to do. Maybe he has thought about that. The public opinion would say that Sweden wouldn't really affect their decision whether they are in for NATO or not. But the political elite, that's the clearest way. The political elite, they wouldn't see the option. And there's this report just last week published, the effects of Finland's possible NATO membership. It doesn't support Finland's NATO membership. They are Teija Tiilikainen, the head of the Finnish Institute of International Affairs, René Nyberg, who is the former diplomat, François Espoir, who is the French researcher, and Mats Bergqvist, the Swedish ambassador. They didn't recommend directly the NATO members, but what they very strongly recommended that Finland and Sweden should stick together, whether to join NATO or not. Thank you.
Thank you. The trust in Sweden, we remember that from our own EU referendum here in Norway. We expected a Svenske suger, a Swedish, I don't know, pull. It didn't really work out, so as we know, but who knows. Excellent, thank you, Thomas. Now, last but not least, Ann-Sofie Dahl. She is Swedish, but lives in Copenhagen, and I give her kind of free task to talk a little bit, you know, covering the what's left, so to speak. You've been studying this for many years. You were, until recently, at University of Copenhagen, the Center for Military Studies, but and you're also adjunct fellow at the CSIS. And now you have left CMS, and you're with the CSIS, an independent researcher. You are co-founder of the Danish think tank called Center for Political Studies, and you also worked at the NATO Defense College and at the Heritage Foundation in Washington. You have also been a visiting fellow at Princeton University and a resident scholar at Georgetown University. You published a lot about Nordic security and about NATO. So yet again, another scholar with excellent knowledge about this topic. So whatever's not been touched by the others is all yours for grabs now. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I need the water because of my voice. I apologize for my voice. Yesterday I didn't have a voice at all, so it's an improvement at least. But I hope you can hear me anyway. As Karsten said, I am Swedish or Skånsk, and I've been living in it's not the same. I've been living in Denmark since 2003, I think it is. But also spent a lot of time in the U.S. and also in Rome, at NATO Defense College. But I have this sort of dual perspective on things, Denmark, Sweden. And I, as you said, have been studying Swedish relations with NATO for many years. You forgot to mention, I also founded the Swedish Atlantic Council. Important. Anyway. There is one thing that could very quickly, dramatically, basically overnight change the situation and improve the enhanced security in the Baltic Sea region, and that would be for Sweden and Finland to join NATO. The two countries occupy a substantial part of the territory and the shoreline of the Baltic Sea. And in particular, they are in possession of two strategic gems or assets, the Åland Islands and Gotland. In particular, Gotland is very vulnerable at the moment. It's a short distance from Kaliningrad. We have seen the simulated bombing attacks departing from Kaliningrad and heading towards Gotland. And it's also without much military presence. whoever controls Gotland is in control of the Baltic Sea, basically. It controls the access to the Baltic states, and it also has the ability to deny access to the Baltic states. So the two non-aligned countries are really the weakest link in the Baltic Sea, in the Nordic security area. They're outside of Article 5 and without the security guarantees. So it's not just a matter of Swedish and Finnish membership of NATO. It's not just a matter of Swedish and Finnish membership in NATO or Swedish and Finnish security doctrines, but it's a matter of regional security or even international security. So that's my first point. And membership in NATO, Swedish-Finnish membership in NATO, would basically turn the Baltic Sea into a NATO Sea, or domestic NATO Sea, internal NATO Sea, and facilitate the defense of the Baltic states. It would also be, I think, of great advantage to Norway. It would enable Norway to focus on the Arctic, the same with Denmark, which could focus on more exclusively on Greenland. And it would strengthen the entire northern flank within NATO and the collective defense within NATO. And this is at a time when there are so many different perspectives in NATO on what is really the threat perception, from where does it really originate. We have the south, we have the north, we have many different perspectives on this. So this would strengthen the strengthen our region and strengthen those who argue in favor of keeping a watchful eye on Russian aggression, on watching out for Russian aggression. But, and this is my point number two, we shouldn't count on that happening anytime soon. And this is also what we should depart from in our analysis, that Swedish and Finnish membership are not around the corner. And some of my colleagues who have argued that this is about to happen any minute now, but this is wishful thinking. Don't get me wrong. As I said, I'm the founder of the Swedish Atlantic Council. I'm a long-time advocate of Swedish membership in NATO, and I would be the happiest person in, well, not the universe, but at least the region, if Sweden joined NATO, but we shouldn't count on it to happen anytime soon. And that is primarily, as Malena said, for domestic reasons. Yes, we have debate in Sweden now, and it's quite entertaining to see how many are coming out in favor of NATO membership now, people who have not previously been known for the support of NATO. And there is an increase in the opinion polls, as we have seen from also Malena. And all four non-socialist parties are now in favor. Previously, it was only not only the liberals, but also the conservatives were in favor of NATO membership. But nothing happened during the 8 years when Sweden had an alliance government, as it was called, not to be confused with the alliance, the defense alliance. But the non-socialist alliance government under Fredrik Reinfeldt, when nothing happened in, there was a lot of movement towards strengthening cooperation, but the membership issue was off the agenda. So that was a time when I think Sweden lost a lot of valuable time, especially the first period, 2006 to 2010. So yes, the four parties are the four non-socialist parties are in favor now, but there's still considerable opposition in Sweden when it comes to NATO membership. The government, the left, and the Sweden Democrats, as Malena mentioned, and which is often forgotten about when we talk about security policy, but they are true nostalgics for neutrality nostalgics. It's very still very traumatic, and there are lots of myths, lots of misunderstandings. Still talk about neutrality, even though that is not has not been the word that we've used for many years. And I think that the trauma that surrounds NATO still in Sweden has been shown or demonstrated quite clearly during the debate that we've had for the past few months about the host nation support agreement, which the parliament will vote on in 2 weeks' time on May 25th, which happens to be my birthday, by the way. Some argue also that there will be sort of a turnaround in policy from one day to another, just like happened with the EU, when there was a shift, very abrupt and quick shift. But NATO is so much more ideological in Sweden. I think one can almost see a division, dividing line on Gustav Adolfs Torg in Stockholm. On the one hand, on the one side, you have the foreign ministry, where there has been sort of a return to the third way, to the Palme doctrine in foreign policy. And on the other side, you have the defense ministry, MOD, which is much more pragmatic, much more focused on cooperation with NATO. And something which is also important in all of this, I think, is when we discuss Sweden and NATO, is that the migrant crisis or the refugee crisis, whatever you prefer, will demand a lot of resources, a lot of attention during a number of years from now on. But one could see some similarities right now with the situation during the Cold War. There's close cooperation, very close cooperation between Sweden and NATO. Only nowadays it's not a secret anymore, as it was during the Cold War. Sweden is now, or was particularly during the Libya operation in 2011, Sweden was referred to as partner number one. I think that Finland and Sweden are sort of competing for the role as NATO's partner number one. Sweden is one of the gold card holders, the Enhanced Opportunities Program, with five countries, Sweden, Finland, Georgia, Jordan, Australia. And you can see sort of the strategic hotspots around the world where NATO focuses on this, on the partnerships in these areas. The Enhanced Opportunities Program is very flexible, very pragmatic, very tailor-made for these five countries. Lots of emphasis on training, on exercises, on information, intelligence sharing. Plus, in addition to this, in addition to the partnership role, the gold card role that Sweden has, there are a number of bilateral agreements, which is also a similarity to the Cold War, when Sweden, instead of sort of, and that is why those who are against NATO membership can say that Sweden did not cooperate with NATO, because it was really bilateral cooperation with a number of NATO allies, primarily the Nordic countries. And the Nordic countries, as we know, are the Nordic neighbors. They're not NATO, really, are they? But anyway, last year or so, we have had, apart from the very close cooperation with Finland that Tuomas mentioned, there's another bilateral agreement with Poland, and one that was entered into only January with Denmark. And especially the Danish one has been interpreted as look, there's another way that Sweden is trying to sort of taking steps towards NATO, another step towards NATO. But it's actually the opposite. It's a way to avoid membership in NATO. These bilateral agreements is a way to circumvent membership in NATO. But it's also a way to, very pragmatic again, way to enhance security, maximize contributions to security in the region and contributions in the to the regional security. And this also shows an awareness today of the vulnerability after Ukraine. And again, Gotland as a particularly vulnerable spot. So we no longer hear the talks that we heard until very, very recently about Sweden is almost a member of NATO. We don't really need to join NATO because we're almost a member. We don't need to sort of go through this very difficult and hard process of applying for membership and referendum and the domestic debate and all of this, because Sweden is almost a member, getting basically everything. And because Sweden has such a a valuable strategic location, there was sort of an assumption that NATO and in particular the US would come to Sweden's rescue anyway, even without membership in NATO. I think that this is a sort of an illusion that people have been living under. The first time I think that this was stated very bluntly, that this was a mistake, this was a misunderstanding, was by Anders Fogh Rasmussen, and the previous Secretary General of NATO, in Sälen, the big conference in Sälen in 2013, when they said that, forget about it, you know, you can't be an almost member of NATO. Either you are a member or not. It's like being almost pregnant. I mean, you can't really be. I mean, it's either or. And very bluntly Danish way of speaking. I think that this was sort of a wake-up call, and this on top of the one-week defense that we heard about right around that time by the then Supreme Commander, and the that was also around the time when we had the simulated bombing attacks. So no more almost a member of NATO, either with us or you're not. Just finally, a simple last point. I agree with Tuomas and with the study, the Finnish study, that when Sweden and Finland, not if, when Sweden and Finland join NATO, it should be done jointly. They should join at the same time. And this time, it shouldn't be the way it was done with EU, that Sweden forgot to mention this to Finland. I know that the Finns are still upset about that. They keep bringing up, my Finnish colleagues keep bringing this up in the very strangest of conversations. All of a sudden, they will tell us that, you forgot to inform us. But I don't think that's going to happen this time when Sweden and Finland join. But when that happens, remains to be seen. Thank you.
Okay, thank you so much. Please ask the panelists to take a seat, and we can open the floor for Q&A and discussions. Since I have the microphone, I will of course use that to ask the first question. But I already noticed one hand, so I will collect. I would like us just, although you think it's unlikely that it's going to happen tomorrow that Sweden and Finland jointly joins NATO, but I would just like to, let's look into that scenario for a second. You call it a Baltic, Baltic Sea will become a NATO sea. What would that happen with Kaliningrad? And I mean, again, what will that do with the kind of, I wouldn't say balance and power, but you know what I mean? How would that kind of shift of, the NATO move to the north, so to speak. I mean, if you can just think a little bit loudly about what you think would be the consequences of such a development. Anyone who like.
There would still be the international waters, and even now, that wouldn't be that dramatic in the sense. Of course, it's more the political military political aspect rather than the military aspect in that. But it all is about the overall circumstances. So because that decision is not going to happen tomorrow, we don't know what in a couple of years' time what the Russia's situation is. I mean, there's a lot of discussion also in this report what the Russia's reaction would be, similar to Russia's reaction to Turkey, for example, or similar to something else. But that's all speculation, and nobody knows it really, because we don't know which time frame we are talking about.
Yes, I agree that it, of course, it depends on what's happening in Russia, what happens to Putin. But this sort of proves the point that it really was a mistake not to, for both of our countries, not to move in the quiet times when we had peace and quiet, and this would not have been seen as provocative in the same way. So that was a big mistake, I think. An additional point would be that Sweden and Finland are already seen as part of the West, and rightly so, as partners to NATO in Moscow. Only the two countries are without the security guarantees. So that, with the two countries in NATO, it would enhance the deterrence.
Can I was thinking about one more thing, is that if, sorry, if Finland and Sweden would now announce that they would apply for NATO membership, there needs to be, and that's also mentioned in this report, but I also personally think, some kind of immediate Article 5 or bilateral security guarantees in order not to leave this kind of time frame where you are applying but you are not really NATO member. There should be, the guarantee should be de facto working immediately from that day when the decision is announced. Otherwise, it would be very, very risky. And that transition is the problem, not the Finland's and Sweden's eventual membership in NATO, but now it's all the time, it's the transition. How you do you get from being not a NATO member to NATO member? That would then be maybe a more stabilized situation again.
You will get the microphone at one point.
A debate just, here.
Just,
yeah.
to again emphasize this, there is another misunderstanding, I think, in Sweden that you know, when you apply for membership, you apply one day and you are a member the next day. I mean, it's sort of like, you know, just sending in the application. But there is this is going to take some time. Even for two countries that are so close and with such a high level of, now I'm going to say the difficult word, interoperability, there's going to be a number of issues that need to be resolved, legal matters, etc. So it's not going to be overnight. I said that it would increase or enhance security overnight. That was a slight exaggeration. But it's important for people to understand that there's a process, and it's not just up to the Swedes. It's also going to be voted among the 28, soon 29 members of NATO. And I mean, we could imagine Turkey using this as, you know, in the present refugee crisis, as you know, using its leverage there somehow. And now you'll get the microphone.
That's fine. I think we should move on to the next.
Okay. Interesting points there about the need for Article 5 right away to the practicalities of actually getting it. We can leave that. Now we have two on the list. First is Ulf Sørdup, our director. You get the microphone from me, leave behind you there.
Thank you so much for this. This is a perfect kind of run-up to the White House meeting. We should have had, Karsten could say something about how this looks from Norway as well. I think... And then Nina can add to that as well. But I think in general, the Norwegian security guarantee is primarily ensured through the US and NATO. And I don't think many would say that increased security to Norway will be added by Swedish and Finnish membership, at least. But it certainly is an interesting topic, and we follow this conversation in Finland and Sweden with great interest. Now, just to widen the perspective slightly, because you have put a lot of emphasis, all of you, on the domestic history, the political trauma or political processes. And on the other hand, you put some emphasis on Russia activities and the threat. But if you widen the perspective slightly, I'm just curious, as I see it, in order to promote Nordic cooperation, we have some significant hurdles to that. And the first is that we have different institutional ties. So you have your NATO difficulties. Norway has its EU difficulties. I think all of them are limiting cooperation on a wide set of security issues, if you take a broad perspective on security issues. So while you have to settle your NATO issue, Norway should settle its NATO issue, I think. But that's one thing. The other thing is that, as I see it, how is the developments going on in Europe, the fragmentation of Europe or the potential for a fragmentation of Europe, how is that impacting on how you see possibilities of a kind of more coordinated Nordic security architecture. That's the first point. The second point is relates not to Russia, but to the US, because there's an ongoing discussion in the US about the burden sharing. This is not only Trump, this is also Obama. It's all, I mean, so we're looking into a future, I think, where Europe will be a bit less of an engine, where the US will say that the Nordics have to come together and take care a bigger share of the sharing of its defense themselves. And that brings me to my final question, because I think a lot of the issues in Norway on Nordic security cooperation, it relates to economy of scale. What can we do in cooperation in order, because all our countries are also struggling with kind of funding the welfare state, etc. So how to make better, more kind of more effective use of our scarce resources. So I'd like to toss in that as kind of widening the perspective, looking a bit more at the Nordic coordination. Thank you.
Excellent. I think I will invite Malena to be the first to respond.
I will start on this one. Thank you. I mean, it's clear, I think, that from a, if you just think of Swedish and Finnish NATO membership from a pragmatic point of view, the best way of enhancing Nordic security cooperation is for Sweden and Finland to become members of NATO, because then you could really have something going in the cooperations that already exist. I mean, there are a lot of cooperation, but there are, as you said, hurdles, and that hurdle is NATO membership. So, I mean, if that was the only thing you were thinking about, how could we make Nordic cooperation more efficient, then Sweden and Finland should join NATO just for that reason. The problem with that is that the domestic policy, you said you've heard enough about it, but the problem is that both in Finland and in Sweden, Nordic cooperation is viewed as something very positive, whereas, as we talked about, NATO membership is not necessarily that positive. So there is this discrepancy between ideas. With regard to burden sharing with the US, I think this is a very important question, because these signals the US have been given for quite some time now, that you have to pull more of your weight in NATO. And even though they have been slowed down by the crisis in Ukraine and Russian behavior lately, they haven't given this idea up. And it's important to remember, it's just been slowed down. And I think, I mean, from that point of view, it's a bit paradoxical, but I think actually the Europeans can thank Russia for US still being in Europe at all. If it wasn't for Russian behavior, the US would have left now. They haven't, but they still want to leave us. They want us to take care of our own security. So also with regards to economy of scale, yes, I mean, we are the Nordic countries are all struggling with how to afford to have a defense. I mean, the Swedish Supreme Commander before, he started to speak about, well, we have to quit one of our branches. We can't afford to have three branches of the armed forces. We have to, you know, stop one of them. I don't know which one yet, but, you know. So obviously, economy is very important, and he has been a very important driver for Nordic cooperation so far. But if you look at Nordic cooperation in security and defense from just an economic point of view, you still reach the NATO membership line sooner or later, even if you try to see it from a pure rationalist perspective.
All right. With the fragmentation of Europe, I think that we've seen that. I'm sorry, I keep coming back to the migrant issue. I just wrote a paper on this. That's why I keep talking about it. About security implications of the migrant question, but it really shows how new divisions have started. I mean, nowadays, I think that the relationship between Sweden and Denmark is as at an all-time low because of this, and we have a border control. You can't just cross the bridge anymore. You have to show your passport. So that shows, I think that's symbolic of the fragmentation that we're seeing right now in Europe. And as I mentioned, we have all kinds of perspectives within NATO, 28, 29 countries with very different perspectives on what is significant, what do we need to focus on. And not everybody agrees that Russia is the main thing. Russia is the big threat. And I think that's one of the sort of the way that Swedish and Finnish membership in NATO would enhance security by strengthening those who argue that Russia is the what we need to focus on, Russian aggression and collective defense, the collective defense groupings within NATO. Just one quick word about burden sharing. We've been talking about burden sharing for as long as NATO has existed, I think. If I may refer to Denmark again, Denmark had a, just like Finland had a review just recently. There was a study presented last week or the week before in Denmark, the Taxe report, a big study of the foreign policy and security policy, which recommended that, or said, repeated that, you know, there is this requirement that all NATO countries pull its their weight, and that they spend 2% of their budget or the GMP on defense. And the recommendation was then that Denmark would do that. But reaction was unanimous that this, yes, it's really nice as an idea, but it's not going to happen. Where would we take the money? Denmark spends right now 1.2%, I think, and it has this huge procurement of fighter jets, which will be announced anytime soon now. So this is going to be very costly. So it's important to keep that goal, I think, 2%. But how do we reach it? It's very far away.
Yeah, but not much to add apart that wasn't it already part of the motivation behind the Nordefco on the side of Norway, that there was uncertainty about the future commitment of the US and the Swedish and Finnish side, that the European defense policy wasn't going anywhere on that, in that pace, and rather it was on the regional groupings pace, that and something had to be done, and the economic scale was the first argument in favor of Nordefco. And that's been continued wherever it's possible. And of course, there are some limits of that. And there will be limits of the Swedish-Finnish cooperation, even where the memberships are compatible. But if we go any further almost than where we are now, there needs to be some kind of a state treaty that guarantees more than that, is not simply on that basis that it's now.
I just forgot one thing about your question about the European fragmentation. I mean, we didn't say any of us, but obviously the eventual Brexit is important for this, because if the UK leaves the EU, one scenario, I mean, there are different scenarios you could think of, but one scenario is that the security and defence policy will leave the EU, and that it will focus, all efforts will be focused towards NATO. So one scenario would be that NATO becomes even more important in the security and defence. Another scenario would be that now finally the EU is rid of the hesitant British, and they could go on with their security and defence policy, and just, you know, no one will pull the brakes all the time. That would be another scenario, and then the EU security and defence policy would actually be strengthened by an exit of the UK. But maybe a more likely scenario is actually strengthening of NATO. So then NATO would be more important. Yes.
Unless, of course, Marie Le Pen becomes president of France, but that's another story. We have two more speakers, questions at least. Nina, Greger here, colleague at NUPI.
Thank you. So many interesting things we heard today. Thank you for that. So many things to pick up on. I will try to sort of limit myself, but just like Ulf mentioned, Norway. I think that a lot of the arguments that you've talked about in the debates in Sweden and Finland are recognizable. But in Norway, we have had to deal with them, like ideology, for instance, the anti-US sentiments that are always there, especially at times with the Iraq intervention, etc. And also, you know, in earlier times. But we have sort of managed to deal with them while being inside of NATO. And the same comes for the relationship with Russia, of course, something that we have to deal with even if we are a member of NATO. And of course, Norway is often a victim to that, falling victim to the sort of overall debate and tensions between NATO on the one hand and Russia on the other, that also is hitting us in one sense or another. But we've always sort of kept the bilateral dialogue, or not always, but always sort of played that card that we can do this bilaterally in any case. Maybe not during the worst crisis like Ukraine, but still there's some kind of communication. So our sort of story has been that you can do it inside NATO as well. So you just, I guess you just have to reach that point in your countries as well. And then just a comment on that. I think for Norway, it would be a great thing to have Sweden and Finland in NATO. More cooperation partners, more collective defense focus, et cetera, et cetera. But I also think that we could risk being a sort of the Nordic group, and we would also, you know, be seen as part of perhaps a discourse that we would not like to be part of as Norwegians, long-term members of NATO. You know, sometimes we are more like the Danes, even if you don't like to say it out publicly. Now, I have a question here. The timing. I mean, the timing is never right, it seems. Prior to Ukraine, it was sort of too early. There was no reason, perhaps, to join. So it was difficult to get the, you know, get the pace and get the debate going. Now it might be too late, in the sense that whatever you, you know, if you should choose to join, it would of course be read by Russia as a very aggressive move, like you also said, referring to the interview. So is there ever a good time for you guys? Sorry. And secondly, Sweden and Russia. Tuomas, you talked about the Finnish-Russian relationship. Very important, obviously. What about Sweden? How much attention do you pay to that? You mentioned it. But I mean, in Norway, it's an ever-constant relationship that we have to deal with. Russia as well. What about Sweden? I'm asking out of curiosity. Thank you.
Who would like to start? Anne-Sophie.
The right time to join NATO, I think it was in 1949. But it's, I guess, I'm sorry that I keep repeating myself, but I think it was, it's really very sad that the four non-socialist parties, which are now in favor of joining NATO, that they weren't able to take that step during the years in government, because, I mean, that government came into power in 2006. That was relatively quiet. That was even before Georgia. And I think that compared to the previous non-socialist government, the Bildt government, when he was prime minister, it was foreign minister in this last one. But when he was prime minister, I think that there was much more movement. And there was a plan. Unfortunately, he didn't work out, but there was a plan. But during these the 8 years of the previous government, there was even a sort of a message from above that this we don't want to touch this. It's much too complicated and too difficult.
No, I agree. No, I agree. I mean, the I'm sorry, the domestic policy comes back again and again here. But I mean, in the first term of the non-socialistic alliance, I don't know what to call it in English. In the first 4 years of when they were in power, they said it's not an issue, and that was. I mean, my conclusion is that it was just because they knew they wouldn't win the next elections. It's easy. It's, I mean, had they pushed the NATO issue in 2006, 2007, 2008, they wouldn't have won the next general elections. So, I mean, it's obvious. We don't know. But I think it's the calculation they made anyway for not. And then they started to wake the question at the end of their second term with the inquiry and getting the Bertelmann report that was finished just after they had lost power. But had they still been in power and the Bertelmann report had come, then we would have had a government now that would have discussed. But I mean, it never happened. So yes, and Russia, yes, Russia. I think the Swedes are really trying to have a conversation with Russia. But as you can see from some of the Russian statements and also actions, it's quite difficult from time to time to discuss with Russia. And also this, as you were referring to the parallel worlds, it's difficult to talk to someone who really sees the world from a completely different light. And that is also obviously what is scaring the Swedish politicians, because you don't want to provoke those powers either. I mean, it's not only about who has the strategic power and who hasn't. It's also about this sort of psychological issue. And would you be put in a place where you state that you were fooled into joining NATO so that Russia could take action. I mean, obviously, this is at the back of the minds of the politicians all the time. So.
It's interesting to see how opinion polls, the support for NATO goes up every time there is some kind of incursion into Swedish waters or airspace. The support for NATO goes up. So one can't help but wonder if Putin is really trying to push Sweden into NATO. I don't know.
Now it's your turn.
Doing his best with Ukraine already. Yeah.
Well, there's been some discussion of people who said that we should have done that the early 2000. But then the problem was that exactly that Finland didn't want to join NATO in the same group with the Baltic states, as I said. Had them been a separate round with Sweden and Austria or some other countries, that would have been quite plausible, because the argument at the time was not that much Russia. It was about synchronizing the memberships and the influence in international affairs and all that. Of course, Russia was always in the background, but that was the key argument and would have been quite different at the time. One, you mentioned the Danish procurement decision, the same applies to Finland. And that will be a big decision, because they're American or Swedish. And that's also where the Trump factor comes in. Because that was the key decision 1994 to have American fighters, to underline the relationship in the changed circumstances. But now it's a different world again.
May I just say one word? I mean, you people complain about us not telling you about the EU membership, but then you went ahead and bought the American fighters. So there are two ways of seeing this.
Yes, I just wanted to say something about what we should have done in 2006. We also have, I mean, it's easy to say now what we should have done or shouldn't have done in 2006, but we have to remember that the world looked quite different then. And it was in Sweden, at least, it was only 2 years after we had the defense bill that said that we don't have to defend our territory. There's no threat to Sweden. I mean, why? It was a non-issue. So obviously you don't want to, I mean, if you're in government, you don't want to wake the dragon that will bring you down, you know. If it sleeps, it sleeps, and then you keep quiet and move on and hope to win another term in office. But also, I mean, NATO looked different then, because NATO didn't know what to do. NATO wasn't really sure about. It's easy to judge from the role NATO has, because NATO is not only the Swedish armed forces that have made a retreat to territorial defense. NATO has also made a retreat to territorial defense. And that was the difference in 2006. And also the role of the European Union, because that was just at the beginning of the European security and defense policy. And anyone who asked me in 2004, should Sweden join NATO, I just said it will become a non-issue. It won't be an issue whether we have to join NATO or not, because we will do what we wanted to do in NATO before. We will do in the EU in the future. This is what we will do. So we really don't have to make a decision on the NATO membership, because it will be a non-issue. The EU will take the role, and you know, we will have some structures together with NATO within the EU anyway. So it won't really matter whether we are members of NATO or not. We will be a strong EU partner. That wasn't really what happened, but you know, it's so easy to sit now and judge what we should have done 10 years ago.
Thank you. Time is running fast. We have one more question there from this lady here, and then I think we should wrap up after that.
Well, I don't need to ask a new question.
Use yourself.
Well, I think I cancel my question.
You, it's a free world. Anyone else then who would like to jump in? Yes, sir, on the front here.
Just a short question to Malena. My name is Kjell Myhre Jensen. You mentioned that there will be no change in Swedish policy before next election in 2018. There's another election in 2018 as well. Putin shall be re-elected. And that is no changes unless something is happening in the Baltics. What do you, in fact, have in mind? Do you see something happening between Russia and the Baltic states, or you more have the Baltic region in mind?
Good question.
I mean, I had the Baltic region in mind, but now that you bring up the Baltic states, obviously they are afraid all the time that something will happen with Russia. And they keep telling us that, you know, you have to help us if something happens with Russia. You have to be aware that something might happen with Russia. So, yes, it could be. I don't know what exactly, but I was thinking more in general terms. And there are also, I mean, there are so many aspects of this issue because there are different things happening all the time on different levels. Now, for example, there's the second North Stream pipe is going to be built. There is a lot of discussion, speaking of Gotland, there's a lot of discussion about that. Should Sweden allow, should the region of Gotland allow the North Streams to have a port on one part? I mean, it would be a Russian port on Gotland. I mean, so there are several different aspects to this issue, but I was thinking more broadly in the Baltic region.
Nobody else? No more comments on that? Okay, well, if that's it, I would like to thank you all for coming to warm Oslo, and thank you all for coming inside in the warm weather. It's going to be cold soon, so 2 degrees on the 17th of May. Thank you so much for sharing your insights and thoughts with us, and thank you for good questions and debates. And this is certainly an issue that will continue to be going on, and which has very important implications for Norwegian security as well. So thank you again for sharing your insights with us. So let's all give them a big hand.